great light dawns in Galilee. Some say madman, some say king. Wonder-working rebel priest, Jesus Christ the Nazarene. He knew well what it would take to free us all from sin and grave. A perfect man would have to die. Friday's good 'cause Sunday's coming. Don't lose hope 'cause Sunday's coming. Devil, you're done, you better start running. Friday's good 'cause Sunday's coming. So let the soldiers take you as his friend betrayed him with a kiss. And there before the mocking crowd, like a lamb to the slaughter, didn't make a sound. Then he carried that cross to Calvary. Then he shed his blood to set us free. As the nails went in and the sky went dark, the redemption of the world was on his heart. Friday's good 'cause Sunday is coming. Don't lose hope 'cause Sunday is coming. Devil, you're done, you better start running. Friday's good 'cause Sunday is coming. Then he breathed his last and bowed his head. The Son of God and man was dead. With bloody hands, tears on his face, they laid him down inside that grave. But that wasn't the end. That wasn't the end. That wasn't the end. Let me tell you what happened next. When we came before the dawn to find that stone already gone, when they looked inside, the living among the dead. He's alive, he's alive, hallelujah, he's alive. Give him praise, lift him high, hallelujah, he's alive. He's alive, he's alive, hallelujah, he's alive. Give him praise, lift him high, hallelujah, he's alive.
He's coming soon. so good to see all of you. My name is Stephen Bird, and I'm the lead pastor here at Central Baptist Church. And once again, I just want to take a moment and welcome all of you here this evening to our Good Friday service. Now, I don't know about you, but whenever I hear those words, whenever we say that phrase, it always gets me every single time. There's always this question that just is underlying all of that, right? Everything that we just heard in that song as well. We use those words, Good Friday, and it begs the question, why is Good Friday good? Knowing all that we know, doesn't that just sound a little strange to you? I mean, just think about it. After all, it's on that day that he who was celebrated became despised. He who was innocent was punished like the guilty. He who was the lion was slaughtered like a lamb. It was on that day that the Pharisees plotted, and it was on that day that the Romans schemed, and that together they carried that out, and they executed the Son of Man, the Son of God, God made flesh. They carried it out, and they put Jesus on that old rugged cross. And it does. It begs the question of why then? Why do we use that phrase that it is Good Friday? Well, I want you to know I've thought a lot about it this week, and I'm sure there are a lot of answers that go to that that could fill in the blanks and aid our understanding, but here's where it all comes down to for it to me. It is the most basic, simple thing. It actually reminds me of a verse from the Old Testament, and you know this as well. We know that what man intended for evil, God intended for good. Those Pharisees, the Romans, all of those folks, they thought they were in control. They thought they were calling the shots. They were premeditating the murder of our Lord. And all the while, God is sovereign. God is in control. And he was predestining our salvation. I love the way that the Apostle Peter talks about it in the very first sermon after all of that. At Pentecost, he frames it this way in Acts chapter 2. We'll put it on the screen, I believe. It says this, "Men of Israel, hear these words. Jesus of Nazareth, a man attested to you by God with mighty works and wonders and signs that God did through him in your midst, as you yourselves know, this Jesus, delivered up according to the definite plan and foreknowledge of God, you crucified and killed by the hands of lawless men, but God raised him up, loosing the pangs of death because it was not possible for him to be held by it." And I ask you, how good is that? That God took the greatest evil ever perpetrated in the history of the world, that the creation would kill the Creator, and he turned it around and he used it to bring about the greatest good, namely our forgiveness of sin and the possibility of reconciliation and restoration through him for all who believe. And so I know that's why we're here tonight. Amen. Friday is good, and as we just said, because we know that's not the end, but Sunday is coming, and we're here to worship our risen Savior. Amen. As part of that tonight, this choir is going to sing a few more amazing songs. Aren't they wonderful? Let's thank the Lord for them, all the work they put in. We're going to have the joy and privilege of joining along here in just a moment of singing some songs ourselves and lifting those up before the Lord, praying together. Also, Brother Andy Cook is here with us. He's our very special guest, our beloved brother over there, and he's going to be wrapping up everything that we've been talking about over the past couple of months in this road to redemption. And he's going to bring it all together for us, walking to Jerusalem, walking through that last week, and ultimately walking us to the cross, where we will remember and where we will celebrate together communion in the Lord's table. You heard Pastor Kevin talk about this a moment ago. If you're here and you haven't had a chance to grab one of those cups, we've got some guys at the doors. You're probably going to want to just sneak out real quick and grab some of those. If you have gluten-free allergy, those are there for you as well. But those are the logistic sides. Let me just deal with the heart of the matter. When we get to that moment, the whole purpose is to still our hearts and to reflect and remember the cross of our Lord and all that he accomplished on our behalf there. We reflect over our relationship with him. If there is any unconfessed sin, that's the moment. Just bring it to him. Amen. Recommit. Have this time of renewal before the Lord. Listen, if you've never done that, if you've never repented of your sins and placed your faith in Christ, do that now. and come and participate, partake of the Lord's table together. You need to make sure that you are a Christian. It only makes sense, right, that we would be a part of His family if we're going to sit at His table. And we hope that everybody here knows Jesus as their Lord and Savior this evening. And then again, we're going to just spend that time reflecting and rejoicing over all that Christ has done for us. As we begin that time, as always, let's now go to the Lord in prayer and ask Him to bless our time together, if you'll bow your heads with me. And so, Father, on this solemn and sacred evening, we gather before You now with hearts filled with gratitude and praise. We thank You for Jesus. We thank You for His sacrifice. We thank You for the salvation that comes only in His name. And as we now journey through this time together, Lord, may Your Spirit guide, may Your Spirit comfort, may Your Spirit draw us closer to You. And then in turn, may our worship be pleasing in Your sight as we honor Your Son and proclaim His victory over sin and death. And it's in His precious and holy name that we ask all of this, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Would you all stand with me as we go to the Lord in His worship this evening? Lord, we know that You gave everything on the cross, and You saved us from our sin. We worship You tonight. Sing with us, church.
I hear the Savior say, my strength is small. To the weakest watch and pray, find in me Thine all. Jesus paid it all to Him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain, He washed it white as
snow. Lord, now indeed I find. Thank you. the place.
There's a place where mercy reigns and never dies. There's a place where streams of grace flow deep and wide. Where all
for the last several weeks, months even, Pastor Stephen's been taking us down the road to redemption. And it's my pleasure tonight, and I consider it a great honor, to show you a little bit of that road, the real road, the road that's in Israel. Because the Bible gives us some geographic markers. We can follow that road. And as always, the land has some secrets hidden in plain sight that will help us understand a little bit more about this story that we love so much. So let's go to Israel, shall we? Let's do it in 25 seconds. I'm tired of those long plane rides. You get to Israel and you can find the road that Jesus took. Now, we don't know the exact path that he took, but again, there are enough geographic markers that can help us understand from the time Jesus told his disciples first that he was going to Jerusalem and would be crucified there, we can follow that path. And you start in Caesarea Philippi. Jesus took his disciples to the region of Caesarea Philippi. And so that's a marker, and you can go there. It's a place where a great number of pagan religions had known the gates of Hades. You see the hole on the cliff? That's actually known as the gates of Hades. It's the Jordan River used to come right out of that hole. In 1837 on New Year's Day, there was an earthquake that struck the region, and it closed the hole. And so the river now comes out a little bit below. But when you look there, the river was coming out of this mysterious hole. There are all kinds of pagan temples around, and he said, you know what? Everything we were doing down in the Galilee, we're going to do up here. I'm going to build this movement, my church, on this rock, and the gates of Hades will not prevail against it. Now, that's usually what we spot when we go to Matthew 16. Maybe we don't see so much that it was also here where for the first time Jesus pulls his disciples aside and said, I'm going to Jerusalem. You're going to go with me. In fact, he invited them to take a cross and follow him. I'm going to be crucified. He always added, don't worry, I'm coming back. And they always seem to miss that part. Well, that's the first time. Now, the Bible also tells us that Jesus went up on a high mountain right after this encounter, and that's when the transfiguration event took place, Moses, Elijah. Well, if you go to Israel, there are some tours who will take you to Mount Tabor down in the Galilee and say this is the traditional Mount of Transfiguration. When you hear the word traditional, you need to realize, okay, this may not be the place, and boy, is this not the place. Look at the high mountain right behind Caesarea Philippi. Jesus and the disciples are walking everywhere they go. The Bible simply says he took James, John, and Simon, who is now called Simon Peter, and he took him up on a high mountain, and there he was transfigured before them. Many times, in much of the year, this mountain is covered with snow. It would be a nice setting if your clothes are going to be brilliantly white as the clothes of Jesus became. And on this mountain, and that's what we've been doing as a church, as Pastor Stephen started this series, The Road to Redemption, it was here, Luke says, that Jesus resolutely turned and set his face on Jerusalem. If you want to know about the road to redemption, this is where it starts. You're as far north in Israel as Jesus ever went. You're as far north as you can go today and still be in the modern state of Israel. And Jesus turns his face toward Jerusalem, and he never turned back. Now, he goes back down to Caesarea Philippi where the disciples, they were struggling. The ones who had left behind, they wanted to heal a little boy, but they couldn't. And Jesus heals the child. And then he begins to coach them again all the way back down to the Sea of Galilee, probably about a two-day hike coming and going to the from those two points. And he goes back down to Capernaum, and he's going to stay in Capernaum for a season of time. And this will be the last time he ever stays in Capernaum. Remember, this is where he based his ministry, right on the Sea of Galilee. When you're on the northern rim of the Sea of Galilee, you're looking at about 80% of the recorded miracles and ministry of Jesus. It's so much happened in this tiny little place on the north end of this lake. And at this place, at some point, and we don't know how long he stayed there, but several weeks, maybe a few months, Jesus pulls his disciples aside again and tells them, the Son of Man is going to be delivered into the hands of men, evil men. They will kill him. They will hand him over to the Gentiles. They'll torture him. And they're going to crucify him. Don't worry, I'm coming back. And the disciples, they're starting to hear this message. Jesus apparently really believes this, is determined to do it. And they were filled with grief. The next time we get a geographic marker on this road leading to Jerusalem, the Bible tells us that Jesus was traveling between Samaria and the Galilee region. And if you look at the large mountains on the right side of the screen, that's Samaria. Those are the Samaritan mountains. And the Jordan River Valley is the southern end of the Galilee region. Jesus here, famously, remember, heals 10 lepers. Do you remember this story? 10 men walk away. He told them to go find the priest. They're all healed. One of them comes back and thanks Jesus. Well, that's the part of the story we remember a lot. But do you know this region of the land like the disciples did? When they're walking through this particular area, they know they're in Elisha country. Elisha was from this region. Elisha, one of the greatest prophets. And Elisha has a healed leper on his resume. Naaman the Syrian came to him, and Elisha says, go bathe in the Jordan River. Naaman didn't really want to. Who would? Look at it. It's not very nice. It's not very big. But he did. In faith, finally he did, and he was healed. And people talked about that for centuries. Elisha heals one leper. Jesus heals 10. You could say that Jesus is 10 times better than Elisha, except that he healed some other lepers and some blind people and some deaf people and some sick people and some dead people. He's infinitely better than Elisha and all the other prophets combined. Well, we're going to move on to Jesus crossing the Jordan River and he's going to go to the other side of the Jordan. So we think modern-day state of Israel and the modern state of Jordan. So he goes over to the Jordanian side. This was actually a common way to get to Jerusalem for a lot of people. They would cross the river twice, they would cross it twice. I guess it was a better way to travel. They get down to Jericho. And now at Jericho, Jesus is going to cross over again. And the Bible clearly says there are a lot of people with Jesus. He's got a small crowd with him. And so they all go across the Jordan. Does that remind you of anything? Do you remember Joshua crossing the Jordan with God's people going up to the promised land? Or what of Elijah and Elisha crossing over together and then only Elisha coming back? There are a lot of stories that happened at this location of the Jordan River. Jesus was baptized here, of course. We don't know exactly where Jesus was baptized, but John had his ministry here at the Jordan River. And Jesus crosses one last time. He goes into Jericho. There he meets, among other people, a man named Zacchaeus. Zacchaeus is not the most ethical man in Jericho. In fact, he's really despised. But then he starts, you know, he gets changed. Jesus has dinner with him, and he gives his heart, he gives his life. He announces publicly that he's going to follow Jesus and change his ways, and he starts handing out tax refunds, and the party's on again. And everybody's following Jesus, and they're going to go up to Jerusalem from Jericho. So they had an early lunch with Zacchaeus because it's going to be quite a hike to get up to Jerusalem. But before Jesus even takes another step, he pulls his disciples aside, and for the third time, 1 week before Good Friday, Jesus says, do not forget why we're going to Jerusalem. I'm going to be arrested, unfairly tried, tortured, crucified. Don't worry, I'm coming back. They never get that part, and they don't even really get the crucifixion part. In fact, James and John right here, that one asked to be on the right and the other on the left. And it throws the entire group into disunity. The Bible says all of the other disciples were indignant with them. And truth is, by the time they got to Bethany, they're arguing over money. By Thursday night, they're not even clean when they come to the Passover meal. And who's going to wash anybody's feet? Of course not. They're really not in a good place, and Jesus has to make this last walk to Jerusalem knowing the group behind him is not unified. It's really not a good scene. Jerusalem is 2,500 feet above sea level. Jericho, 680 feet below sea level, lowest city on earth. The road connecting these two places is one of those places we don't have to say this is the traditional path. This is actually the path. We can say this definitively. And the reason we can say this narrow little path is the ancient road that leads from Jericho to Jerusalem, or, as Jesus said in the parable from the Good Samaritan, a man was walking down from Jerusalem to Jericho. The reason we know this is there's water on the path. There's no water 40 miles north of here. There's no water, with one exception, no water 140 miles south of here. But in this canyon, they call it a wadi, in this canyon there are three water sources, three little rivers. So when you run out of water, you can get some water. But what are you worried about as you see this and you think about walking on that path? If, I wouldn't want to fall, would you? That'd be the last trip of your life. And I think about all the people who walked on this road. Mary and Joseph walking to Christmas. Maybe Ruth and Naomi coming home to Bethlehem. David fleeing from Absalom on this road. All the disciples so many times had walked on this road. Yeah, it's kind of frightening. And so we also remember, see, I told you there's water on this road, a lot of water. We remember, if you imagine Mary being worried about taking her young, growing family, as Luke says at the end of chapter 2, they went to Jerusalem for Passover every year, and maybe she's worried about these children, or maybe her mother's going on this trip. You're worried about falling. You're worried about so many things. It's hot. Maybe they sang the song that every generation sang on this road. It's even labeled a climbing song. Number 121 in the psalm book, I lift my eyes to these hills. And I've got a question. Where in the world am I going to find help today? Well, my help comes from the Lord, the maker of the heavens and the earth. And you know what the first promise is? He will not let your foot slip. Sun's not going to harm you by day, nor the moon by night. He's going to watch over your coming and your going both now and forevermore. If the journey is tough for you tonight on this particular Good Friday, your job is to sing the songs of faith and keep walking. That's what this road tells me. Well, Jesus and his disciples get up to Bethany, where Mary and Martha and Lazarus 2.0 is, you know. And they're going to have the Friday night meal, the Shabbat meal. And they're not going to travel any. They're not going to do anything on Shabbat, on Saturday. But on Sunday, we call it Palm Sunday, Jesus leaves Bethany and comes over the hill, the Mount of Olives. And he intentionally chooses a donkey to ride down this hill. Zechariah the prophet had said, Jerusalem, one day your king will come to you, lowly, on a donkey. But that's how you're going to recognize him. And Jesus intentionally chooses a donkey, and people cheer for him, and they're saying, Hosanna, Lord, save us. And the Romans are on alert, and the chief priest, and everybody's a little nervous. The high priest is determined more than ever, I'm going to kill that guy. And you've got just a few days before Passover itself and Good Friday. I want you to pay attention to this incredible illustration. See the altar in front of the temple? All day long, animals died on that altar. Oh, birds, goats, lambs, bulls. It's just a never-ending stream of sacrificial blood on that altar. Every day, you know, not everyone could afford an animal for every single day. So every day, both in the morning and in the evening, there was a collective sacrifice for all of God's people. They called it the morning sacrifice, and they called it the evening sacrifice. The day starts early in the Middle East. It's hot as the day goes along. And so people start to knock off work between noon and 3. You know, and by 3 o'clock, you're really at the end of the day. But I want you to think about this. The first sacrifice, usually right around 9 a.m., would have come at this altar, a lamb dying for all of God's people. And all over Jerusalem, people would have heard a trumpet blast because a man stood. See the far corner of the temple structure? That's the southwest corner of the Temple Mount. And archaeologists found an inscribed stone that had fallen off. The Romans threw it off. And it said, the place of trumpeting. A man with a very long trumpet with a special sound blew that horn every morning at 9 a.m. and every evening at 3 p.m. to let people who were not right there at the temple know a lamb has just died for your sins. If you will take this sacrificial gift in your heart and just say, God, I accept that gift, then you can be in a right relationship with God. And in the evening, as the day comes to a close, as you're bringing that day to a close, they would also add a song, a verse from one of the Psalms. Everyone just instinctively said it. It was a part of corporate worship for Jewish people. You know what they said? Everybody all said, into your hands I commit my spirit. I've often wondered, how did the gospel writers know that when Jesus said, into your hands I commit my spirit? Well, how did they know it was 3 o'clock? It was dark. There was no way to tell by the sun. Nobody had a wristwatch. It was that. It was the sound of that horn. It was the daily sacrifice. It was the daily ritual. And isn't it incredible that Jesus took part in corporate worship as part of his last breath? Well, from here, it's not very far to the place where Jesus was crucified. And if you go to Jerusalem, you can walk down the Via Dolorosa. It's a short maze of streets. It's a winding little path, and it only takes 10 or 15 minutes at the most to walk the Via Dolorosa, the way of suffering. And you know, that could be said that, you know, or people might say, that was the way of suffering. That was the Via Dolorosa. But you know what? You know the truth. Jesus had been walking this Via Dolorosa, this way of suffering, for many weeks, a few months, maybe the better part of a year. Jesus had turned and set his face toward Jerusalem when he was on top of Mount Hermon. And he would not turn back for one reason and one reason only. He was determined to give you and me redemption.
But the crowd pressed in to see a man condemned to die on Calvary. He was bleeding from a beating. There were stripes upon his back, and he wore a crown of thorns upon his head, and he bore with every step born of those who cried out for his death. Down the Via Dolorosa, called the way of suffering, like a lamb came the Messiah, Christ the King. But he chose to walk that road out of his love for you. Down the Via Dolorosa, all the way to Calvary. Por la Via Dolorosa, triste día en Jerusalén, los soldados le abrían paso a Jesús. Mas la gente se acercaba para ver al que llevaba aquella cruz. Por la Via Dolorosa, es la vía del dolor, como oveja vino Cristo Rey, Señor. Y fue Él quien quiso huir por su amor, por la Via Dolorosa al Calvario y a morir. The blood that would cleanse the soul of all men made its way to the heart of Jerusalem. Like a lamb came the Messiah, Christ the King. But he chose to walk that road out of his love for you, for me. Down the Via Dolorosa, all the way to Calvary.
If I were to take you to Jerusalem today, you'd be amazed perhaps at how large the city is. It's a major city. I mean, almost 1 million people live inside the city limits of Jerusalem. And if you take in a few communities of greater Jerusalem, it's far more than 1 million people who live there. I mean, this is not the place that Jesus knew. I guess you can tell that, right? And so we use some illustrations and some animation to try to see what Jerusalem would have been like. And that explains why, for instance, the traditional location of the crucifixion that you might see when you go to Jerusalem at the Church of the Holy Sepulchre, it's inside the walls of the old city today. But when Jesus was alive, it was outside the walls, that particular area. The walls of the city, these old city walls, well, actually, they're not that old. 550 years old. Jesus lived 2,000 years ago. The walls have changed their location in this old city some 16 times. That's news from the archaeologists. The city was destroyed a few times in warfare. It was expanded by many politicians and remodeled by others. So the city is always moving. It's kind of a flexible city for a city surrounded by stone walls. And there we have before us the great Temple Mount. Temple Mount, 37 acres of open space in a city that's so crowded, you can barely get a motorcycle in some of the streets, much less a car. I'm just going to show you around. I'll be a tour guide for just a second. This is from Bethany, flying over the Mount of Olives toward the west. And so this would be the scene that we would have seen as Jesus comes into the city every day as he stayed with Mary, Martha, and Lazarus. And he would go back to their homes, apparently, and spend the night, and then he would go back into the city, and he spent most of the time of this last week of his life around the Temple Mount. Coming down the Mount of Olives on that donkey, Zechariah had prophesied, your king's coming to you on a donkey. And so there's the Mount of Olives, got a lot of olive trees in the past. Right now it's got a lot of graves. Why does it have so many graves on it? Well, Jewish people have read the scripture that says the Messiah is going to come, set his foot down on the Mount of Olives, it's going to split, and that will be the incredible age that begins. Now, we believe Messiah has already come, and he's going to return to that location. But Jewish people have read that scripture. They believe it, and they want to be buried there on the Mount of Olives so they can get a front row seat to all that happens. The Gold Dome building is the Dome of the Rock. It's an Islamic structure. The temple was 2.5 to 3 times larger than the Dome of the Rock. Underneath the Dome of the Rock is, not surprisingly, a rock. And Abraham, by tradition, is supposed to have come to this location, and that's where he nearly sacrificed his only son, his son whom he loved, named Isaac. It's almost as if God says to Abram, as he stops him from taking the life of his son, if anyone will ever sacrifice his only son in this place, it will be me. Jesus hears his disciples just being astounded by what truly was the greatest temple in the world. There was no building like it. I mean, there's just nothing like it 2,000 years ago. And he pulls them aside to the Mount of Olives, sits them down, and he says, the day is coming when not one stone will be left standing on another. And do you know, 40 years later, after Jesus said that, that's exactly what happened to this magnificent structure. The Romans even tried to destroy the Temple Mount itself, and they gave up. And when you see Jewish people praying at the Western Wall, it's because those stones are what was left remaining from the last Temple Mount retaining wall structure that once held the temple. Now we're going to turn around and go back toward the Mount of Olives, and I want to make sure you can see the Mount of Olives. It's not always easy to see, but it's a long hill in the distance just beyond it, the Judean wilderness. You can even see that in some of the picture. You can see the hills behind it. That's the Judean wilderness. And in the haze, down at the bottom of the hill, and I mean really at the bottom of the hill, there's the Dead Sea. Between the Mount of Olives and the Old City is the Kidron Valley. There's several stories connecting the Kidron to Bible stories. David, when he ran from Absalom, crossed the Kidron, goes up the Mount of Olives, and that's where he was betrayed by a good friend who had dipped his bread with David. And David never got over the betrayal of Ahithophel. There's a betrayer coming up in this story, too, on the same mountain, in the same Kidron Valley. Because just across the Kidron, John says we had to cross the Kidron and we went into a garden. It's the garden of a place where they turned your olives or your grapes into money. It's an oil press, Gat Shemin oil press. The garden around the Gat Shemin is where Jesus liked to stay when the holiday started and he couldn't walk all the way to Bethany. The Church of All Nations here marks the traditional location of where Jesus prayed in the Garden of Gethsemane. We don't know exactly where he prayed, but if you're here in that church around those old olive trees, you're within a few steps of where it happened, and you can pray there. You can say to God anywhere you want, I guess, but it's a powerful place to say, not my will, but yours be done. Your glory, my good. Show you where the Passover is. Now, in the modern-day city, and again, the modern-day city gets in the way. I mean, it just kind of messes with your eyes, but There was a lower Jerusalem where David had lived, and then there was an upper Jerusalem, and the Passover meal was somewhere over in the upper Jerusalem area. Now, again, you look at the modern-day old city, you're going, where was Jesus crucified? There's just houses and churches everywhere. That used to be an open area 2,000 years ago. But that's where the crucifixion took place. In fact, if you use this illustration to see, you can see all three categories. You can see where they had the Passover meal. They crossed the Kidron, went into Gethsemane just on the other side, not in this picture. And then eventually Jesus is arrested, taken back over to the area where they had the Passover meal the night before. And that's where he was unfairly tried and finally taken to Pilate. We're not quite sure where Pilate was when he handed down the sentence. But Jesus was finally taken outside the city walls and crucified. That last meal, that Passover meal, so important, so special to all of us. We call it communion, the Lord's Supper. Jesus taking his disciples through a story that they knew so very well. And by the way, if you're not convinced that this was the Passover meal they were having, just read the Gospels. More than 20 times it says this was the Passover meal. Jesus told his disciples, go prepare for the meal. It takes a lot of trouble to prepare for a Passover meal. Some of you have probably participated in one if you've ever had to do that. It's the world's most symbolic meal. It tells the story of the Exodus, and the little bits of food all along the way help tell the story. Do you remember the Exodus? You know, the people had been held as slaves for too long. Moses is going to be the savior for the people. And the Bible calls them signs. We call them miracles or plagues. But the Bible calls them signs. Moses would give signs to Pharaoh that Pharaoh was not God. There is a God, Pharaoh, and you're not it. You need to let my people go. Pharaoh was a very poor sign reader. He had blood in the water. He had frogs. I got to stop on frogs for a minute. Have you ever read this story? Moses goes to Pharaoh, and he's like, would you like to get rid of the frogs? And he's like, would you please ask God to get rid of the frogs? Moses says, I will. I give you the honor of choosing when I shall ask God to make the frogs go away. And Pharaoh said, tomorrow. Tomorrow. Moses said, as you wish. Have a good night. I say that because there may be somebody here who's been waiting a long time to make a key decision that you know you should have made for a long time, you know? And I would like to ask you, do you really want to live one more night with the frogs? Why don't we make the right decision tonight and make this a most memorable Friday? There was darkness right before the death of every firstborn son. Do you remember the cross, what happened between noon and 3? Horrible darkness. And the only way to protect your family, your firstborn, you took a lamb. And if you read the scripture, they took this lamb into their home for 5 days. They didn't have pets like many of you have. But you love your pets, right? Can you imagine? You bring a lamb into your house, the children name it, they put a collar on it, they pet it, they fight over who gets to sleep with it, your wife wants to, you know, take it and keep it. And then Moses says, okay, Dad, you're going to have to cut the throat of this lamb and collect the blood in a bowl. Oh, what pain. I think if we could visualize that, it might help us remember that sacrifice is not simply something we sing about or remember. It is incredibly painful. And I want to live my life differently because of the sacrifice that was given for us on Good Friday. The death angel would pass over any home marked with the blood of the Lamb. Jesus is with his disciples, and he tells that story. Every family around Jerusalem, and there literally could have been, Josephus says, hundreds of thousands of people around the Jerusalem area. They love to go to Jerusalem for Passover. They're all telling the same story. The meal is the most symbolic meal in the world. Every part of it tells the story of the Exodus. And Jesus tells that story on what we would call Thursday night, but when the sun goes down, you get a new day in Jewish life. You see, in their minds, when the sun went down, it was Friday. Good Friday started last night in Jewish minds. I'd like to share with you a little bit about the symbolism of this meal that we know so well. There's bread that's unlike any bread in the world. Let me bring the lights up just a little bit so we can see all of this. Thank you. And it's something unusual about modern-day matzah bread. You know, it has no leaven in it. Personally, I love leaven. Yeast rolls. This has no leaven in it. Only during the week of Passover does leaven represent sin. But it's a big deal in Jewish homes to get rid of all the yeast in your house. All the yeast has to go because this week, yeast represents sin. Jesus took this incredible bread, and now his unleavened bread looked different from this modern-day matzah, but for several hundred years, this has been the bread of Passover. Isn't it interesting that it's got little holes in it? It's been pierced. It also is cooked in such a way that it has stripes. By his stripes we are healed. He was pierced for our transgressions. And Jesus said, this sinless bread, it's my body. And then there was the cup of wine. The wine so symbolic all the way through the Bible. And in the Passover meal, there are 4 cups of wine. I have 5 here. I'll explain that in just a moment. And you would only get, if you go to a friend's house for Passover, you would only get 1 cup. It would be refilled 4 different times. But everything in the Passover meal is symbolic. And each one of these cups has a name. This is the cup of sanctification. It begins the meal. It's a worship service. And so they sing, they have a certain scripture and a prayer, and they take the cup of sanctification. And by the way, Jewish people vary on these names just a little bit. And so if you hear different names, don't worry about it. But basically, this is the cup that gets things started, the cup of sanctification. The second cup is the cup of deliverance. And between the first cup and the second cup are going to be all those elements of the meal where you tell the story of the Exodus, where you eat the bricks made with straw, and you taste the salt water, which represents the tears that the people had as they were slaves. That all happens before the big feast. And the Passover meal is a big feast, like Thanksgiving for us, or Christmas, or maybe Easter Sunday. Big meal. Then there is the last cup. I want to skip over to the fourth cup. The fourth cup is a cup of praise. It was traditional to sing one of the Hallel Psalms and to drink one last cup of wine as you finished off the night. Do you remember the Bible says they sang a song and went out into the night? Also, there seems to be an indication that Jesus did not drink this final cup. He said, I'm not going to drink from the fruit of the vine again until I come into my kingdom. Which leaves the third cup. When Paul was writing the people in Corinth, many of them had a Jewish background, he said, after the meal, Jesus took the cup. And he would say of this cup that this represented his blood. This is known as the cup of redemption, the cup of salvation. And there is a fifth cup. No one would ever drink the fifth cup. A plate is set in modern-day Passover meals for Elijah, and a cup is prepared for Elijah. There's even a game where one of the children will go to the door and look to see if Elijah has come. You know, if Elijah comes, the messianic age is upon us. God is moving. That's why so many people ask John the Baptizer, are you Elijah? They were looking for the coming of the Messiah, and Elijah would announce the coming. But no one wants to drink the cup that's set for Elijah, because if the Messiah comes, God's cup of wrath is going to be poured out on the nations. This is a cup you don't want to drink. And I remember when John and James did make that power play of saying, I want to be on the right, I want to be on the left, Jesus asked them, can you drink the cup I must drink? They said they could. Jesus said no. And in the garden, what was the language Jesus used when he was struggling? Would you please take this cup from me? But he took the cup. Not my will, but yours be done. He took the fifth cup so you and I could drink freely from this one. If you would like to participate in communion tonight, I invite you. To take and eat. And likewise, if you have accepted this amazing grace, drink deeply and freely the cup of salvation.
Thank you.
There's something that Jesus said on the cross that we, as a people, have tended to miss all of our lives. We're not Jewish, most of us in this room, maybe all of us are not Jewish, and yet the Bible comes to us out of this Jewish environment. The more you learn about the foundation of our faith, the richer the gospel becomes. And I'm so glad we were grafted into that vine. Now, one of the things we need to know is that Jesus was constantly teaching from the text. We would call that the Old Testament. The connections between the things Jesus said and scripture that's in the Old Testament are so many, you cannot count them all. They are everywhere. That's one of the reasons, after the resurrection, when Mary sees Jesus for the first time, she calls him Rabboni. And look what John adds as an editorial comment, so non-Jewish people would understand, he's a teacher. That's what that title means. He was such a teacher. And constantly he's teaching. I'll show you just a couple of examples. I can't possibly show you all I would love to. It would take weeks. But the phrase Jesus said, I'm the good shepherd. That's such an innocuous phrase. It's such a nice picture of Jesus. We sometimes cross-stitch that verse and hang it in a child's nursery. But there were people who said, well, don't listen to him. He's probably got a demon. He's that mad. It says something like, I'm the good shepherd. And seriously, when you read it and just stop and look at that response, you go, did I miss something? There are other things Jesus will say where people will leave the conversation and go make plans to kill him. Those are clues that we did miss something, and what we missed was scripture. Let me show you what this one is all about. This one is all about. Jeremiah, Ezekiel, and Zechariah love to use the phrase of shepherd to talk about Israel's religious leaders and political leaders. And they had this blistering rebuke for the shepherds of Israel. Ezekiel saying, I've got a message from the Lord. You guys have made such a mess of things. The day will come when I, the Lord, will come down there and do it myself. I will be their shepherd. I will bring them home. I will heal their wounds. I will give them pasture. Jesus says, I'm here. And they said, you're crazy. Again, we don't have time to do much of this, but I'll show you one that happened on the morning of the crucifixion. Jesus has been arrested, has been held prisoner, he's been beaten, and now he's taken before Caiaphas, the chief priest. And Caiaphas says, let's just quit beating around the bush. Tell us by the living God, are you the Christ or not? Are you the Messiah or not? And instead of saying yes or no, Jesus has this cryptic kind of saying where he says, you will see the Son of Man coming on the clouds of heaven, you know, and for those of you like me who grew up with the King James Bible, we just got used to Jesus talking in poetic language, and we just go, I don't really know what that's about. I wish he had said yes. But Caiaphas understood exactly what Jesus was doing because Jesus was quoting scripture. Why don't we watch this? The high priest tore his clothes. They all said, he's spoken blasphemy. They were ready to condemn him, take him to Pilate right now. I know it's a holiday, but he dies today. They spit on him, hit him with their fists, slapped him. That's not normal. These are clergy. It just doesn't happen where somebody well-dressed in a professional atmosphere walks up and slaps somebody. The Academy Awards notwithstanding 2 years ago. I bring that up not only because it's kind of funny, but do you see how unusual that is in our culture? You probably didn't even watch the Academy Awards, but everybody the next morning was talking about it. They're doing this to Jesus. Don't ever get used to what they did to Jesus. But why did they do this? Why did they react? They said, are you the Messiah? And he says, you're going to see the Son of Man coming on the clouds of heaven. It turns out he's quoting scripture again, even on the last day of his life. It's from Daniel chapter 7, one of the most important chapters in the Bible, the loftiest chapter in the Bible when it comes to a day of judgment. You want to see the great day of judgment in the Old Testament? Go read Daniel chapter 7. And when everyone is ready to be judged, everyone who's ever been lived, one like the Son of Man is coming on the clouds of heaven, and he is the one who's going to judge everybody, including the high priest, the chief priest, Pilate, you, and me. When Jesus answered with that scripture, Caiaphas knew exactly what he had said. All of those other Jewish people knew exactly what they had said and said, "You just crossed a line. We're not going to let you uncross." Always teaching. After the resurrection, he would explain to his disciples. Remember the two men on the road to Emmaus? They were the first to get this incredible lesson. All about himself that the scripture had been saying. And if you've ever wanted to know what Jesus said, if you've ever kind of grieved that that wasn't included in the Gospels, let me give you a great good news. Every time you hear a sermon from Simon Peter or John in the book of Acts, you're hearing what Jesus taught them. Every time you read in Paul's great theological messages to his churches, you're reading what he learned from Jesus, from the eyewitnesses. It all connects with him. Always teaching, always teaching, always teaching, even on the cross. The examples are incredible. He had said at the Sermon on the Mount, "Do good to those who hate you. Turn your other cheek. Bless your enemies. Love your enemies." And he gets to the cross. They're literally nailing to the cross, and Jesus is asking the Father to forgive them. Here's another place where he's, oh, I got to say, just keep that in mind right there. They cast lots for his garments. It's going to come up and again in a minute, and I'm not going to mention it, but you're going to see it. John, who wanted to be on the right or the left, he wants to be a key leader in the kingdom. Jesus, discipling him, gives him his first assignment of leadership. "I want you to take care of my mother." It's elder care for somebody who may be 17. John, if you can learn how to take care of one person well, if you can learn how to put somebody ahead of you, at that point you're probably going to be qualified to lead my people. "I'm looking for shepherds, John, so take care of my mother." That's teaching. That's what that is. "I am thirsty." This from a man who has nearly been tortured to death before the cross, and now he is dehydrated. Why in the world would you say that's scripture? But you see, that's what John said. Scripture was being fulfilled right here. Well, where does it say in the Bible, in the Old Testament, that somebody was thirsty? There are a couple of options, but one I would like to bring to your attention comes from the middle of something called Psalm 22. Psalm 22. Can you? There we go. "My mouth is dried up like potsherd. My tongue sticks to the roof of my mouth. I'm dried up. You've laid me in the dust of death." That's the middle of Psalm 22. "Into your hands I commit my spirit." That comes from Psalm 31. "I trust you, God. If I die tonight, I'm committing my hands into your spirit." There is also, "It is finished." Asa, asa. That's the Hebrew, tetelestai in the Greek. "It is finished." That's a scripture quotation, and I think it comes from the very last line of Psalm 22. And then there's the one that troubles us most of all. "Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani? My God, why have you forsaken me?" Did the Father really turn his face away from Jesus right then? Was this all a mistake, as some of our critics and non-believers will say very loudly? Look at what Jesus said. Well, I have a question for you. After we do this, look, I want to do the four references to Scripture. If you just take away the corporate worship, you've got the first verse of Psalm 22, a passage from the middle, and you have the last verse from Psalm 22. It could be Jesus wants us to notice Psalm 22. Psalm 22 was written 900 years earlier by David, also written 400 years before anybody on the planet was crucified. David must have wondered at some of the phrases coming out of his heart and into his song. It's a very unusual song. Psalm 22 was also one of the songs in your songbook, the 150 songs. Jewish people knew all of those songs. You know, there are some of us in the room who don't need a Baptist hymnal because we know all of the favorites. We can just sing together. We could break out in song at any point. There's something about a song that helps you remember it. Every Jewish person at the cross, not the Roman soldiers, every Jewish person at the cross had memorized Psalm 22. They knew its haunting words. So, Jesus refers them to the first line of the psalm. When there are no chapter verses, there are no verse numbers, the only way he can get their attention is to say, my God, why have you forsaken me? And they all go through the rest of the psalm. Why are you so far from saving me? So far from the sound of my groaning. I call to you by day and you do not answer. By night, I'm not silent. Yet you are enthroned as the Holy One. In you, our fathers put their trust. They called to you, you answered them. They cried out to you, you delivered them. In you, they put their trust and they were not disappointed. But I am a worm and not a man. I'm despised by all people. All who see me mock me. They pass by, they shake their heads, they wag their tongues. They say, he trusts in the Lord. Let the Lord deliver him. Let the Lord save him, since he delights in him. But you called me forth from my mother's womb. You made me trust in you, even in my mother's breast. From birth I was cast upon you. From my mother's womb you have been my God. Oh, my Lord, come quickly to save me. Save me from the sword. Save me from... There is trouble is near and there is no one to help. Bulls surround me. Strong bulls of Bashan encircle me. Roaring lions that tear apart their prey have opened their mouths wide against me. I am poured out like water. All of my bones are out of joint. My heart has turned to wax. It has melted away within me. My mouth is dried up like potsherd. My tongue sticks to the roof of my mouth. You have laid me in the dust of death. Dogs surround me. A band of evil men encircles me. They have pierced my hands and my feet. All of my bones are on display. People stare and gloat over me. They divide my garments among themselves. They cast lots for my clothing. Oh, my strength, come quickly to save me. Save me from the sword, my precious life from the power of these dogs. Rescue me from roaring lions. Save me from the horns of wild oxen, and I will declare your name to my brothers. In the presence of the great assembly, I will praise you. Before those who fear the Lord, I will yet fulfill my vows. All you who fear the Lord, praise him. All you descendants of Jacob, honor him. Revere him, all you descendants of Jacob, all you descendants of Israel, for he has not despised or disdained the suffering of his afflicted one. He has not turned his face away from him, but he has heard his cry for help. From you comes the theme of my praise in the great assembly. Before those who fear the Lord, I will yet fulfill my vows. The poor will eat and be satisfied. Those who seek the Lord will find him. Oh, may your hearts live forever. And the ends of the earth will remember and turn to the Lord. All the families of all the nations will bow down before him, for dominion belongs to our God, and he reigns over the nations. The rich will feast and worship. Those who go down to the dust will kneel before him. Those who cannot keep themselves alive. And posterity will serve him. Future generations, look at us tonight, will be told of the Lord. They will tell of his righteousness to a generation yet unborn. For he has done it. At that moment, Nicodemus and Joseph, remember Joseph of Arimathea, Nicodemus, who hadn't quite worked up the courage to be a believer, at that moment they knew two things. They were at the foot of the cross and the Messiah was on the cross. No doubt about it. Scripture had said. Scripture convinced them of something that Lazarus had not been able to convince them of. This was the Messiah. And they had missed him. Because the other thing they were convinced of is that man was dead and they would never see him alive again. And so they took his body gingerly and wrapped it and put the ointments on it. At the risk of their own arrest, they treated Jesus like a family member, like their own rabbi, and they laid him in that new tomb that Joseph was building. walked away, rolling the stone in front of that tomb, and all hope was lost. Now, I know you know the end of this story. But wouldn't you like to go back to that scene and go to Mary, the mother of Jesus, who is holding the corpse of her son, rocking him one last time? And say, Mary, don't give up. This is not the end of the story. To John, the beloved disciple, and all those disciples hiding in all the corners watching from a distance, it's not over. Joseph, you're going to get a chance to talk to him. Nicodemus, you can get a chance to talk to him and hear how the scripture was played out. Don't give up hope. This story is not over. I know it's a horrible, horrible thing and you can't imagine it, but one day you're going to come back and call this Good Friday. One day you're going to, believe it or not, you're going to talk about the beauty of the cross. And I want to tell you tonight, if you happen to be in one of those low places in life and you feel like hope is about to drain away forever, it's not over. This story's not over. It may be Friday, but I want to tell you, my friends, Sunday's coming.
Again, as we close out our time together tonight, I just want to thank all of you for being here on this Good Friday. I want to thank Brother Andy Cook for leading us on this incredible journey. Amen. Thank you, brother. And I know the point is clear, that every step, every movement, every motion from the heart of our Lord was to take Him to Jerusalem and to take Himself to a cross where He died for us there in order to redeem us from our sins. Amen? That's what this day is all about. And that's because of that, we don't want to close out this day without offering just a moment of invitation to say, if you are here today and you've never trusted in this Jesus, as Brother Andy said earlier, I pray that not another day goes by without you placing your faith in Him. Please know our pastors will be here following the service. If you are not a believer, if you're not a Christian, please come talk to us. We'd love to walk through the scriptures with you to show you what that means, how you can know Jesus and know the salvation that comes only through His name. So we invite you to do that here tonight. And for all of us who are here, we'd love to invite you to join us on Easter for three different services, three different times, 8, 9:30, and 11. We hope that you'll all come back, be with us here. Why? Because we know this, Friday is good, but Sunday's coming. Amen. We hope to see you there. God bless you.